how did it begin? I don't know. I loved film when I was a kid. There was a film society that would show, you know, you could then rent 16 mil copies of film. So they would show in the winter, they would have screenings and show things like last year in Marienbad and Alphaville and Peter Watkins' War Game we saw. It was a film that was banned for 25 years, but we actually got to see it. And that kind of, I think, stimulated my love of film. Mm-hmm. But I never in my wildest dreams imagined that I could, you know, work in the film industry for a living, because my father was a building contractor. And, you know, it was a small seaside resort in southern England, and I didn't have any connection to the film industry, London or anything like that. So it just gradually evolved. I went to art college and discovered photography. And at that point, a friend of mine was interested in film, and he was applying to the National Film School. Mm-hmm. And I thought, what a wonderful idea. So I applied to the National Film School, and really I didn't get it in the first year, but I got in the second year's intake. And I think that really changed my life, gave me the opportunity to get experience of shooting, but also get confidence that I could do it, you know. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Уште од самиот почеток покажувате интерес за документарниот филм. Го започнувате вашиот голем проект, каде што 9 месеци сте биле на јахта. Тоа е голема авантура.
I did a lot of documentaries at film school, and as well as dramas at film school. And then after I left the film school, I just went into doing documentaries, because yeah, that's what I loved. It was like an extension of my still photography, which I had done then for a number of years. And before I did the Round the World Yacht Race, I did a film in what was then Rhodesia, about the war in Rhodesia. And then I went on this shot this documentary that originally Chris Menges was offered, because he worked at this television station and did most of their documentary work. And I'd met Chris, and so I got the chance to do that film, yes.
You've been on boat 9 months?
Yeah, it was 9 months. It was probably a little more because I had to train, because there was myself and a sound recordist, and we had to train to sail as well. So we crewed the yacht. There was like 10 or 11 of us, depending on the moment. And we had to sail the yacht and then make the film in our spare time, which was kind of not much, but yeah.
Big adventure.
Yeah, it was a big adventure. Yeah, I was I have amazing memories of that trip, you know.
You said, if you can photograph the human face, you can photograph anything, because that is the most difficult and most interesting thing to photograph.
Yeah, I think so, yeah. But I think it's kind of what it's about. For me, that's what it's about. I mean, I guess, again, it's coming from my documentary work. It's like, you know, it's about people. Mm-hmm. So the human face and the expression of the human face, yeah, I think I don't know, it sounds pretentious, but to get to photograph the essence of somebody, you know, I think it's the hardest thing, so yes. If you can do that, you can do anything.
Во раните 80-ти години работите ТВ спотови и ТВ серии, но во тоа време не било вообичаено да се работат ТВ спотови.
Well, they weren't that rare. And I mean, in the 80s, there were a lot of music videos being made, actually. But it was great. It was a great time to do them, you know, because I got to work with some pretty good people, like, you know, from Eric Clapton to, you know, Meatloaf, and, you know, people. I mean, I worked with a lot of really great acts, you know, so it was fun, and it was a great way of just experimenting . So fine, it's such a rush, helps to redeem the mind, and it's good for us, sexual healing, baby, it's good for me, sexual healing is something that's good for me, and it's good for me, and it's so good to meet my baby, oh, I'm thinking.
make love tonight.
Michael Redford is impressed with your work on the BBC series Walcott and asks you to start to work on his upcoming film Another Time, Another Place. You knew him from the film school. He was doing a fairly low budget film, and on the Cannes Film Festival this film received a 10 minutes ovation.
Yes, it did quite well there. I mean, it's not quite right what you say, because I didn't really know Mike at the film school, but because he was in the first year and I was in the second year. Mm-hmm. But after I left the film school, he was doing arts documentaries and he did a music documentary with Van Morrison, for instance, and he asked me to shoot those for him. So I kind of worked with him in documentaries for a while. Mm-hmm. And then I did this television series, Walcott, yeah. And he said to me, because I had the experience of doing drama professionally, although I'd done a lot of films at the film school that were dramas, he asked me to do Another Time, Another Place, yes. And that was really my first... I'd done one feature before that as well, actually. I'd done two features before that as well. But that was my first real... Well, I break, you know, you say it, but it was the first film I shot that received a standing ovation at Cannes, and you know, people saw it, you know.
Yes, and big success.
Yeah, well, I think the biggest success came out of it was at that Cannes. I was not there, but Mike said to me when the Another Time, Another Place was shown, a producer came up to him and asked him what he wanted to do next. Mm-hmm. And he said, I've always wanted to make a film about 1984, though he didn't expect to be able to do it. Mm-hmm. And this producer said, okay, well, let's do 1984. Mm-hmm. So that film led to 1984.
Yes. Really. The world we are preparing, Winston, is a constant victory, a constant triumph. You are beginning to accept it. You'll soon welcome it. And finally, become part of it.
In that film, you using a process known as bleach bypass.
Yeah, well, it wasn't. It was, yes. For various reasons, we couldn't shoot in black and white. Mm-hmm. So we experimented in different ways to desaturate the color. Mm-hmm. And so the lab in London kind of developed this process that was what they call bleach bypass process on the print, which leaves in the silver that's used in the development process is left in the print, and that made it a semi black and white image. Yeah. I think it was the first major film that used that kind of technique, other than Keizu Miyagawa in Japan, who had used it a few times late in his career, but he called it silver tint, but he never told anybody how he did it. So it wasn't like we used his process. I just know it had been used before, so there was a way of doing it. You know?
Welcome to Los Angeles, Mr. Fink.
Excuse me? Howdy, neighbor.
Are you a writer, Mr. Fink?
Actually, I'm writing for the pictures now.
Неговата кариера како кинематографер може да се подели на два периода. Првиот, британскиот, е од средината на 70-тите години, кога најмногу снимал филмови со режисерот Майкл Редфорд и со Майк Фиджис. А вториот период, американскиот, започнува од 1990-та година, кога со режисерот Боб Рейфелсон го снима својот прв филм «Планини на месечината». Следната година, 1991-та, го снима филмот Бартон Финк на браќата Джоел и Итан Коен, со кој ќе изгради најплодна соработка, станувајќи нивен партнер кинематографер, снимајќи ги сите нивни филмови од кои добива и најмногу номинации за Оскар.
Thank you.
Let me ask you something. What's the most you ever lost in a coin toss?
Look, I need to know what I stand to win.
Everything. Just call it friendo.
Your agent received a script for a strange movie about playwright suffering writer's block.
Yeah.
And he advised you to turn it down. But you accept the offer.
Yeah. It was because, I asked who the director was. And the agent said it was the Coen brothers. And I went, well, why wouldn't I want to work with the Coen brothers? So I read the script, and unlike my agent, I really liked it. I thought it was really bizarre, but it was really interesting. And I met with the Coen brothers, who happened to be in London, and we just sort of got on very well, I think, you know, and they offered me that film. I mean, I was very lucky because they were doing a film in Los Angeles. This film, Barton Fink, was being shot in Los Angeles, and it was low budget, and they wanted to shoot non-union. So frankly, they asked somebody from England so that they didn't have a problem with a union. Yeah.
Како ја започнувате вашата работа на филмот? Во која фаза од подготовките се вклучувате вие?
Well, I like to have a lot of prep time. I like to, especially if I've not worked with a director before, I like to have that time with the director to understand what they want, you know, their approach to the script, but also really to get to know the material. But sometimes you can't, you know, sometimes I've been on one film and I've gone very rapidly onto another film, but you know, usually I mean usually I have a 6-week prep period, but for instance now I'm prepping a film that won't shoot, I'm doing a bit of prep on a film that won't shoot till April next year, so I'll have a lot of prep on that.
How do you choose a script? How do you know which movie to choose?
I think, well, if I pay my money to go and see it in a cinema, then I think I'd like to work on. No, I mean, if it's something, it's like, what book do you read, you know? Read a book and it affects you, you read a book and get halfway through and it's not doing anything for you. It's the same thing. If I read something that moves me, affects me, I feel it has something to say about the way we are, then that's interesting. I don't choose a script because it's like big and got lots of big sets and spaceships and stuff. That's not really interesting to me. It's if it's something that makes me feel something, you know. I think movies are the great movies that that inspired me as a kid. They're not, you know, it's not all just dialogue, you know, it's, which is what movies tend to be these days. But it's this combination of sounds and images that it becomes something more than what's written on the page, you know, something that affects you in a way that is intangible, can only be film and sound and that kind of.
You like to combine documentary style with film style. It's happening on Kundun with Martin Scorsese.
Well, I think Marty offered me that job because I had shot a lot of documentaries. And the film, all the actors in the film weren't actors. You know, they were Tibetans that had experienced it. That was their life. So that's why I think Marty offered me the job, because I'd be used to kind of like working in a situation with non-actors, you know. But it was one of the greatest experiences of my life, working on that film, yeah.
What about lighting? Is it determinal to good shot?
I think the problem with lighting is not the problem with lighting is, but I think the danger with lighting is that you light something to look attractive when it might not necessarily be right for the shot or the moment in the film. You know, I think lighting, you can enhance the storytelling with lighting, or you can destroy it as well, actually. It can be very distracting if you're not careful. I guess, again, maybe it's my documentary background, but no, just my sensibility is one of naturalism. And I don't like an audience to be aware of lighting, you know. And sometimes the lighting can be quite fanciful, like maybe it was in Blade Runner, but I always try and put it in a context that is believable. You know, that the audience feels that this is a real world that they're in, not something that is just there because it looks attractive or, you know, it's clever. You know what I mean?
You make your lightning diagrams, I see on.
Yeah, internet. No, that's what, again, why I like a lot of prep, especially on a film like Blade Runner. I mean, I like a lot of time talking with a director and a production designer, and then figuring out exactly a plan of how I want to light it, you know. I think you have to do on a film like that scale. And because I operate the camera myself, I don't want to be distracted by the lighting when I'm actually filming the actors. I want to then it to be about the camera and the camera's relationship to the characters, and not about, oh, I need to move that light or something, you know what I mean? It's, yeah.
Did you just jump into sci-fi, or you have always wanted to do science fiction film?
Well, you see, the science fiction is science fiction, isn't it? You know, I love science fiction. You know, I love Philip Dick or whoever, you know, the different writers, Ray Bradbury and Heinlein. I mean, I just love science fiction writing, but I don't find a lot of films that are made are really science fiction. They're science fantasy. I always loved Tarkovsky's Solaris. For me, that was true science fiction. And so it wasn't really till I was offered Blade Runner that I had a chance to work on something that I really felt was science fiction but had something to say about the human condition rather than being pretentious.
Fire. Yeah. Go north. Fire. Stop. 20 degrees east. Stop. Zoom in. Closer. Oh, come on. Get up.
What is the biggest challenges in your career?
You know, I mean, the thing is that the challenges are not one of scale. It's sometimes that the smaller film like Fargo can be a bigger challenge, have bigger challenges than... the biggest challenge is the one I'm going to do next, I think. It's always the next one.
Always. Always is
yeah,
the next
because,
one.
Yeah, because there's always something you've got to kind of like find out and something that you've, some problem you've got to overcome. What's past is past, and yes, a lot of those problems that I had to deal with now, I don't really think about so much. I mean, there's all sorts of problems, like on the Coen Brothers film, Oh Brother, Where Art Thou? We had the problem of how you create the kind of image we wanted, and we went into sort of a whole digital kind of world to get it, you know, but now I don't remember that problem so much. I'm just thinking about this problem of the next film.
What is your relationship with the actors while you're filming movie in front of your camera?
Well, that's why I operate. I love being there. Mm-hmm. I'm the closest person to the actors, mm-hmm. really. I kind of love that, you know. And you know, sometimes you don't have a close relationship, and other times the actor's actually not relying on you, but it's like likes to look at you at the end of the
yes.
take to see what your always. Reaction to that take is, you know, and you feel that connection. I kind of love that, you know. And I love sometimes in the right space you can then talk to an actor of just about the head turn or, mm-hmm. or you know how you move, how they move with the camera, because mm-hmm. it's all like a, if you've got a lot of moving camera, it's like a dance, it's like a ballet mm-hmm. between the actors and the camera. So you know, I like that involvement. That's
yes,
yeah,
they believe you very much, believe in you.
Well, it depends who it is, but you hope. You try. I mean, I think a huge part of a cinematographer's job is create a space for an actor to do their work in. Because mm-hmm. if you haven't got that performance, you haven't got a film. If the audience don't believe the character and the acting, mm-hmm. it doesn't matter how nice the lighting or pretty the shots are, it's a bust. It's about that character. So the cinematographer's job is to create that space, that comfort zone for the actors to do their work, isn't it?
Yes.
You know, really.
Интернационалниот фестивал на филмска камера Браќа Манаки, како прв и најстар светски филмски фестивал, апсолутно е посветен на креативноста на светските кинематографери. Голема чест представува присуство на врвни мајстори на камера токму на овој фестивал. Истата година кога Роджер Деакинс го добива својот прв Оскар како најдобар кинематографер за остварувањето во филмот Blade Runner 2049-та, фестивалот Браќа Манаки му додели значајна награда за животен опус, Златна камера 300, како исклучително значајна личност во светот на филмот.
Roger, it's a big pleasure for me. I'm not going to say much, thank you. I really am. It's a cliche, but I'm really the wrong side of the camera. I want to be that guy over there. Thank you so much for the welcome. Thank you. It's really a great honor. It's wonderful to be part of this history of this festival. And that's it. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Have you heard about this festival from your colleague? How do you know?
I think the festival's been going about the same time as I've been shooting feature films, about 39 years. Yeah. I know so many people that have been here before, you know, and I just never had a chance to come. And I'm so pleased to be here, but I'd say I'm standing here after I know so many of my friends, cinematographers, that have been here in the past, so I'm very honored.
Awards, you know, I'm just glad to be doing the job and doing something I really love, and I love my life. So the awards are kind of like icing on the cake, you know, and a lot of the greatest cinematographers never got an award, so, you know.
The Oscar goes to John Toll for Legends of the Fall.
Oscar goes to John Seal for The English Patient.
And the Oscar goes to Russell Carpenter for Titanic.
The Oscar goes to Peter Pal for Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon.
And the Oscar goes to Andrew Lesney for The Lord of the Rings, The Fellowship.
Claudio Miranda, Life of Pi. The Oscar is going to go home with
Gravity. Emmanuel the Best.
And the Oscar goes to
Chivo.
Emmanuel Lubezki.
Manuel Lubezki, The Revenant.
Going there to see my father.
We need to keep moving! Come on!
Going there, no more tomorrow.
We can't possibly make it that way, man! You bloody insane!
If you don't get there in time, we will lose 1,600 men. Your brother among them. Good luck.
Ah!
Roger Deakins, 1917.
This is the second Oscar and 15th nomination for Roger Deakins.
Thank you. Wow. I want to thank my fellow. I want to thank my fellow nominees for their wonderfully inspiring work, but more than that, I want to thank them for their friendship, too. I'm a pretty good cook, actually, but this belongs to a lot of people that worked on this movie. It belongs to my wife, James, who worked on it with me. It belongs to my assistant and focus puller, Andy Harris, who is somewhere up there. Who is the pinball wizard of focus pulling, and you'll never know what he does, because you'd only notice it if he makes a mistake, and he never does. It's to Peter Cavacuti and Charlie Rizek, two fantastic operators. It's to Gary Hymns and a grip crew, and John Higgins Biggles, who's been my friend for about 30-odd years, who's our gaffer. So it's to them and all their wonderful team. And I think they would all want me to say thank you, Sam Mendes, for the most wonderful experience. Thank you. We'll never forget it.
Your style is always different.
Well, I don't think it's my style, it's the scripts, isn't it? You know, the scripts and the directors I work with and what they're trying to achieve. So, you know, your style develops depending on the script and the intent of the film. I suppose I have an overall style that is one of realism, but that doesn't mean that I don't do something like The Man Who Wasn't There, which, you know, doesn't, you know, that has quite stylistic lighting in it. But I wouldn't say I have a style. I don't have one way of doing things. If I were coming in and lighting this, one day I would do it one way like this maybe, and another day I would do it totally differently. It's kind of, you know, so in that sense I don't have a style or a formula, you know. Thank you.
Do you have any advice for young photographers?
No, just stick to your own ideas and your own, you know, like I said before, develop your own way of seeing, basically. Don't try to copy somebody else. It's not interesting. I want to see how somebody else sees the world. I don't want to see a reflection of the way I see the world. That's mm-hmm. pointless. You know what I mean? Yeah. We're all different, so everybody's got a different way of seeing, and everybody is interested in different things, you know. So mm-hmm. I think that's my advice.
With your wife, you are in the same industry. Yeah. Is it your life like is like a film?
Like a film?
Yes.
No. But it is about film, yes. Our lives together is very much about film, yeah. I mean, we met on a film, and nowadays we always work together, so yeah, it works.
Yes.
It's for us, I don't know how we would have a relationship yeah. if we weren't working together, so. Yeah.
To make things easier.
Yeah, it's very nice. We complement each other, I think.
Yes. Thank you very much.
Hey, my pleasure. Yeah.
For interview. Sure.